building a rocket engine in my garage. A project such as this has many hazards, including risk of fire and explosions. Building this engine is not recommended and may put you at serious risk without proper safety precautions. For a long time now, I've been experimenting with many types of rocket engines and afterburners, but they all had one big issue. They all had relatively low exhaust velocity, meaning their efficiency was pretty terrible. This project began as an attempt to build an engine with supersonic exhaust using a convergent-divergent nozzle to get the highest possible exhaust speed and thus efficiency. My initial idea to achieve this goal was to use a super powerful electric compressor similar to my last pyroflask engine. After multiple design attempts and only one explosion later, I was able to push my original pyroflask compressor to just over 6.5 psi. I didn't think this would go supersonic, but I wanted to give it a test to see how it compared to previous versions. Unfortunately, 88,000 RPM was way too much for my little overvolted motor. I could have continued to pursue the compressor approach with a ridiculous number of stages and an obscenely powerful motor, but I was already considering another idea for supplying large amounts of high-pressure air. I thought of using a large 11-gallon air accumulator that could store up to 100 psi of compressed air. It'd run out in a few seconds, but while it lasted, it would supply more than enough air for supersonic flow. I set up a system that used a simple spring valve that I could release with a solenoid. This would quickly dump the air through whatever engine was attached. Going into this project, I had a vague understanding of rocket nozzle design, but only had experience with subsonic convergent nozzles. This meant that I needed to find formulas and be able to use them to find the ideal geometry. I found the most useful formulas from NASA's website and a few other online calculators. I soon had a prototype nozzle and I wanted to visually confirm its performance before moving on to using fuel. One way to do this is with a technique known as Schlieren imaging. This uses mirrors or lenses to see small variations in gas density, such as the patterns in a supersonic jet of air. Those patterns are called shock diamonds and occur from the exhaust interacting with the atmosphere at supersonic speeds. They form diamond-shaped standing shockwaves and are a good indicator for nozzle geometry. For example, a nozzle that is overexpanded, meaning that its exit is too wide compared to its throat, will create a Mach disk, which is bad for efficiency. On the other hand, an underexpanded nozzle will create a different Mach disk that is further away from the nozzle. An ideal expansion will have no Mach disks, with the shock diamond coming to a clean point at about 0.67 times the width of the nozzle.
3, 2, 1.
As it turns out, my first nozzle was overexpanded, likely due to the pressure drop in the plumbing that I hadn't accounted for. I reformed the nozzle and tried again, this time with a perfect expansion in the middle of its operating range.
In 3, 2, 1.
This is exactly what I was looking for, and I was ready to retrofit it to my test stand for hot fire testing. Even though every analogy has its flaws, a reasonably good one that describes flow through a rocket nozzle is the water analogy. It shows the pressure of fluid in a two-dimensional flow setup with a level of water corresponding to how much pressure or potential energy is in certain parts of the nozzle. The speed of sound could be represented by the wave speed on the water surface. In the chamber, the pressure or water level is very high and the speed is comparatively low. In the convergent section, the fluid is constricted and forced to accelerate. In the throat, the water should be traveling at its natural wave speed, or Mach 1 in the case of a real rocket engine. In the divergent section, the residual pressure is exchanged for speed as the pressure is ideally lowered to the same level as the external environment. The level of the output flow is representative to the expansion ratio mentioned earlier, with undesirable interactions or lost energy resulting from an incorrect nozzle design or input pressure. Now that my nozzle was of a correct design, it was time to integrate the accumulator into the test stand along with all the additional fuel plumbing and control hardware for a hot fire test. I placed the tank onto my mobile test stand that formerly held an earlier failed attempt at a rotating detonation engine. I changed out the spring valve with a giant servo valve because it was easily resettable and gave me throttle control. I routed the pre-ignition system to a control panel and programmed an Arduino controller for the main fuel, air, and ignition control. I rerouted all the plumbing and displayed an assortment of gauges that displayed important pressure information. Now that I was introducing volatile propane gas to the system, I had to get serious about fluid control and safety precautions. I installed numerous check valves at all points connecting to the engine and installed a flammable gas leak sensor inside the air tank to alert me if there's a dangerous fuel backflow. I also designed an intentional overpressure failure point in the 3D printed adapter to avoid a more catastrophic case detonation. My test stand also has a super thick steel plate shield to hide behind during testing in case the engine has an overpressure. Once I got the test stand finished and the engine installed, I was ready to start the test. I waited for the air accumulator to fill and activated the pre-ignition system. Unfortunately, this chamber design would tend to flame out at high flow rates, no matter what fuel ratio I use. It is also really picky about its fuel ratio, even at low flow rates. This is a problem because it was unable to sustain combustion during full flow operation. After many unsuccessful tests, I decided to do a major design change and go with a completely different chamber design. I luckily came across my old pyroflask combustion chamber, which had performed very well in past tests with a wide range of acceptable fuel ratios. I only needed to adapt it to my test stand, as well as replace the nozzle with an optimized supersonic one. I kept the same dimensions as the last design and machined it out of brass so it would fit into the new chamber. I checked the nozzle with my Schlieren imaging setup and proceeded to the next test.
In 3, 2, 1.
With the nozzle's performance confirmed, it was time to attempt another hot firing. With lots of hard starts and the 3D printed adapter rupturing, this design is looking no better than the previous one. I redesigned the adapter and the igniter so it would have less chance of building up excess fuel in the chamber. Once it was reassembled, I gave it a try at about half power. Here, post test. First really successful test firing. Looks like the gasket was slightly extruded. Everything else seems to be in good condition. Let's see the temperature. It's warm, but not bad. Not bad enough to melt 3D print. Looks like we had some leakage by the spark plug. Overall, things seem to be in pretty good condition. I think it's good enough to fire again. After that first successful test, I wanted to try it at full power to see how much thrust I could get. After seeing those glorious shock diamonds, it was now time to go through the test data. Looking at my measurements, the maximum thrust achieved was 2.73 kilograms, or 26.8 newtons of thrust. Peak thrust was achieved almost immediately and gradually decreased as the air tank ran out until it was shut off. The tank pressure for all full power tests was approximately 90 psi with some slight variation. Peak chamber pressure was about 68 psi and also decreased as the test progressed. I shut off all tests when the chamber pressure dropped below 20 psi because the flow is no longer supersonic at that point. I also noticed that there was a pretty consistent pressure drop between the tank pressure and the chamber pressure of 7 to 10 psi. This was likely lost mostly in the check valve and the 90 degree fittings on the air feed line. Looking at a comparison of a hot fire versus cold flow test, the difference is huge when conducted with the standard 90 psi tank pressure. The hot fire test achieved a maximum of 110.9 newton seconds of impulse, as opposed to the 38.8 newton seconds of a cold flow. Looking at efficiency values, rockets are typically measured in specific impulse, or measure of how much impulse it gets per amount of propellant. Because this engine used about 189 grams of total propellant mass and got 110.9 newton seconds of impulse, its efficiency is still not that great, with about 59.8 seconds of specific impulse. This efficiency is comparable with solid-fueled model rocket motors, which are still able to reach respectable altitudes. This efficiency looks even better when compared to the cold flow specific impulse of 23.2 seconds. Although its performance is still lacking compared to the space shuttle engine, I was extremely excited by the fact that I was able to achieve supersonic exhaust. Based on the impulse, I can figure out that the exhaust is going about Mach 1.3 on average, which is still faster than I can imagine. Is this engine practical? No, not at all. The whole air tank and other systems easily weigh over 30 kilograms. But is it an awesome research and education tool? Absolutely! It is an excellent testbed to improve my engine design to a possibly flight-worthy prototype eventually. There are so many improvements to be made to this existing version, such as better gasketing, an automated starting sequence, and perhaps an aerospec nozzle to deal with variability in supply pressure. Over the 5 successful test firings, this engine remained fairly consistent. It also is pushing the maximum pressure that can be supplied by gaseous propane because my fuel tank pressure was only 10 psi higher than my chamber pressure at full power. To get more performance, I would likely have to switch to a different fuel and ideally pure oxygen instead of air. However, pure oxygen can be incredibly dangerous and expensive as it requires all components to be oxygen rated. Plus, a hard start condition in pure oxygen would surely result in a much more catastrophic explosion. This project has been a great introduction to how complicated rocket science really can be, and gives me a newfound appreciation for all the high-performance rocket engines that are used in spaceflight today.
Oh, yeah, there. I'm going to put this in the bottom.